you. I love you, baby.
Friday night, 10 for some straight talk. This is your host, Matt Hasley, coming at you. We, picking up audio there. I'm trying to get the audio done. On the one side, sometimes it seems to work and sometimes it doesn't. A little Barry in the background there. So, special thanks to our sponsors out there, eat24.com. If you haven't ate yet, well, log on to eat24.com. Download that app for your favorite mobile device. Click order and eat. It's a food truck in your pants, really. You know, it's just that easy. Also, Louie from hotsaucevault.com. Check him out. He's got hottest of the hots. He's got wimpy for the wimps. And he's also got gag gifts, you name it. Christmas coming up. 23 days. Hard to believe. But log on. Get your gift now. Also, Lyft. Need a ride somewhere? Check them out. LYFT. No, I don't want to install an update now. I love how it happens to pop up right when I'm in the middle of my show. At least it didn't go, hey, we're shutting your system down and 10 minutes or something like that. That's usually what I get, one of those. What to talk about? What's going on in the news? If you're sports, which you just got done listening to sports, but Tiger's back. And first round, he didn't play so well. I mean, he played good and bad. I mean, a little rust. Second round, Tiger shoots a bogey-free 65. Not the lowest of the round of the day, but very respectable 700 par, bogey-free round. He had to do a little bit of scrambling, which is good. I was glad to see him play well. Pretty cool. He hit the shots he needed to, hit the pitch shots that he needed to. A lot of people were worried about the short game. And you just, I'm watching Notabagay, which was a teammate of Tiger's at Stanford, and he's on the broadcast, and he's very, you know, he's good friend of Tiger's, so I mean that it's, he knows him very well. But you got Brandel Chambly, and Brandel Chambly is kind of that, yeah, oh well, I want to see him do good, but God, I want him to fail. He reminds me of the Joe Buck of the World Series, about wanting the Cubs to fail, because he's a Cardinal fan, you know, through and through. So, I mean, you just listen to Brandel Chambly talk about how, because he was so outspoken about Tiger in the Masters 2 years ago, about how Tiger should have withdrew because he took an illegal drop and blah, blah, blah. But, I mean, Tiger didn't do anything wrong. I don't think Tiger should have been penalized. You know, they made a decision that it wasn't, you know, that he didn't do something wrong. Then later went, wait a minute, after his comments in the media, well, then he did do something wrong. So, you know, I mean, they've already made a decision not to penalize, and then they penalize him. So, I mean, I don't know. It was, Brandel Chambly was really outspoken, and he's been outspoken against him. And you just see him, where like he's gritting through teeth. Oh, it's so great to see Tiger playing good again, you know, just biting his teeth. And you're just like, you know, this, I mean, the average person probably didn't even notice it, but anybody that knows that he's got issues with him could tell. And Tiger played great. I mean, he played, shot 65. He went from, well, he was in, I don't know, last place or whatever. There's only 18 players. It's all the champions, you know, certain, whatever champions. And he went from last place to now he's tied for ninth. Justin Rose had to withdraw because of back problems. So, You know, looking at, you know, he was, what, 9 shots off the lead to start. Now he's, I think with the leaderboard, I just looked at it here. Dustin Johnson and Hideki Matsuyama are both leading at 12 under. And then you got Kuchar and Oosthuizen at 10. And then you got Bubba Watson and Brant Bubba Watson at 9, Brant Snedeker at 8. And then you got Jordan Spieth, J.B. Holmes at 7, and then Tiger, Ricky Fowler, Henrik Stenson are at 6. So if you're looking at it, the way the pairings go should be tomorrow. You're going to see Dustin and Hideki Matsuyama together, Dustin Johnson, Kuchar and Oosthuizen, Bubba and Brant Snedeker. I would love to see Jordan Spieth play with Tiger, but it looks like it's going to be Jordan Spieth and J.B. Holmes, and then Tiger and Ricky Fowler. Tell me that won't be a big draw. If Tiger and Ricky are together, that's going to be a huge group to follow. I mean, every group's a great group. You got, you know, the rest of the group's on the way out. J.B. Holmes, who was 12 under at one time and kind of had a really bad stretch of holes coming down the end there, ended up at 7 under. But it'll be, it's going to be Henrik Stenson and Brooks Koepka, and then Patrick Reed and Zach Johnson. And then Russell Knox will be the odd man out. Russell Knox, Emiliano Grillo, and then Jimmy Walker will be the odd man out. I'm sorry. He'll be playing solo like Tiger did today. Tiger was paired with Justin Rose. Rose pulled out, so Tiger played. He played the front 9 an hour and a half. So he had a nice, smooth round. So he didn't have to worry about, you know, slow play, anything. You know, they're talking about trying to speed up golf, and they're talking about trying to, you know, Nicklaus had come out, and he had talked about, you know, how the modern ball and the clubs have ruined golf and ruined golf courses. And, you know, I idolized Nicklaus, I mean, since I was a kid. I mean, he was my favorite. But before I get right into that, you know, they're talking about, you know, with Tiger, and you look at Dustin Johnson and you got Bubba Watson, how far most of these guys hit it. You know, they're talking about also about not just the ball, it's the tour player. You look at most of these guys, like Dustin Johnson, I mean, he's 6'4", 6'5". Bubba Watson, same way, 6'3", 6'4". You know, they're all taller players, stronger players. They all have strength coaches and fitness, you know, I mean, you know, dietitians and everything to help them eat right and train right. They do everything that golfers didn't do years ago. I mean, they're stronger now. It's like the NFL. I mean, you look at the players. William Perry was, what, 301 or something like that when he was playing, and now they got guys that are 350, and they're fast and not as heavy looking as Perry. It's amazing. These guys, I mean, it's just the players are evolving, and you know the golf courses have not, because they have not gotten longer. Some of the new ones are, you know, they're over 7,000 yards. But you have these, you know, the older courses that Nicklaus is talking about how they're starting to become obsolete. But the problem is, and he goes, they want to limit the ball flight, you know, and cut the ball down so it doesn't go as far. The problem with limiting the ball flight is the guy that's long now is still going to be long. He's just going to be longer with a different golf ball. The guy that's shorter than the guy right now is still going to be short. He's going to hit it, you know, less far. You know, he's not going to hit it as far. And if they made that to where it went, somehow we're able to adopt it over golf nationwide and all over the world, golf would kill it. It would die. Because the reason why is these people, they buy the driver. They want. They just had the driver versus driver by Wilson. And one of the key characteristics they talked about was that people look for, is it the longest driver on tour? Or is it the longest driver out? That's what people want. They want distance. They don't care if it's the straightest driver. If you, I mean, you could tell the guy that he could hit it. All right, let's see. You can hit it 340 or you can hit it 280 right down the middle every time. The guy will take 340. I mean, because he thinks he doesn't realize that 340 in their trees is 340, you know, in trouble. They don't care. They want the distance. Because that one drive, did you see how that drive went? You know, that's what they think about. And this is where I differ with Nicholas' opinion, because the problem is a shorter hitter or the senior player or whoever it is or the junior, they're going to be even shorter. And to sit there and try to have two different golf balls, one for the tour player and one for the amateur, and I just think it's going to be too much of a mistake. I think it's going to end up doing is killing golf to where, I mean, right now it's on a downward trend because of, I mean, believe it or not, Tiger brings so many people to the game that never played golf before. He made golf cool. You know, some people still don't play it. They go, oh, I'm not playing that, you know. But he made it to where a lot of people came to the game to try it out, and they got to enjoy it. You know, I mean, I don't know too many sports where you can actively participate at any age. You could have a grandfather, son, grandson, whatever, playing together, and it all enjoy a game of golf together. There's not too many sports that you can't do it in, football or baseball or basketball. You know, you could all have a, and it's not something that's, okay, we did it in 30 minutes, all right, it's over, let's go on. It's something that takes 4 hours. You could, good time of the day where you could spend time out in the nature with your family, with your husband, wife, brother, mother, significant other, whatever it is. I mean, you can have a good time. Oh, you know, I mean, you got people in leagues and everything. I mean, it's just the social aspect of golf is unbelievable. The business aspect of it, of making business deals while you're playing golf. But, yeah, you look at golf being on a downward trend. Well, one, the economy is the biggest thing. Is, you know, if you got a guy that, or somebody that's a golf fanatic, well, if they have less amount of money coming, you know, in their pocket, well, that's less time that they have for leisure activities. And if you got guys that play golf and gals, that's less times that they'll get out to the golf course. So, you know, it's I know the merchandise is on the downward trend because I can't, you know, I run my own golf shop. I can't compete with, eBay and Amazon and all the box stores. We call them you know, that have no allegiance to this area. They're run by, you know, big, you know, the last weekend, Saturday, was Shop Small. Well, I mean, we hardly had any play. I don't think we had any play. But, so hopefully, maybe it'll carry over for this week and they'll Shop Small again this weekend. But, yeah, we're talking about only being a 39 for a high tomorrow. They're playing in the Bahamas right now. It looks really nice. And, you know, shirt sleeves. It's 39 for a high today. We had, ended up with 20 right before I left. Had two come out right before I left. But, amazing at 39 degrees. But the wind chill was about 34 or whatever. People just don't want to give up the golf, you know. Yeah, right now in New Providence in the Bahamas, it's 75 degrees. So, yeah, that'd be nice. I'll take that. Take that year round. But no, I just think that Nicholas is kind of off and out of touch with the, you know, he's got the aspect of the tour player in mind. But the problem is everybody, I don't care if it fits them or not. The average guy picks up Golf Digest, opens it up and goes, oh, here's a golf tip. Stop slicing the ball. Or it might be one, here, this will cure your hook. And the guy might have a big, giant slice. Oh, this one's for me. They don't realize that it has nothing to do with them. You know? But they read it and then they see whatever the tour players are carrying. That's what they want. They want exactly what Tiger's playing or exactly what Phil's playing or exactly what Jordan Spieth or Rory McIlroy or Bubba. You know, I've seen Bubba plays a pink driver. It's by Ping. And I know a guy that plays every Sunday that has one. His wife got it for him, and he's left-handed, like Bubba is. And, I mean, he was thrilled to death to get it. And there's a lot of people that's what they want. They want exactly what the tour player. And it might not be the right club for him. You know, you look at when there's a NASCAR win, how many people are the allegiance to that brand. You know, if a Chevy wins or Ford wins or a Toyota wins or whoever, what company, it really pushes that brand. And it's any product placement that they do. And that's what to do. You got a guy that's walking billboard. And he's got, you know, Titleist or TaylorMade or Adidas or Mizuno or whatever it is, or Callaway, all, you know, Nike. Well, Nike's getting out of the club business, but they're still in, you know, clothing. But you look at, all the brands, if they're not on tour, a lot of people don't even realize they're even still a company. Well, they got this new company coming out. It's been out the last couple of years, but it's starting to get a lot of airplay and get a lot of commercials. PXG, not the club for the average player. I mean, it's expensive. We've seen it. It's some bucks. I mean, big bucks. So you watch the commercials, you see it. They're really a nice looking iron. I don't even know one of the reps that sell them. Haven't seen one in person, just seen pictures of them. But they got some big names. And the big names will not switch unless they think it's the right thing. So you got, you know, Zach Johnson playing it, you know, like that. You get the names because they know it's something that they can win with. So got two more days of the Hero Challenge. It'll be, you know, be interesting to see how Tiger does. You know, I don't expect him to win. I think he will win. I don't think he'll, go winless this year. If he stays healthy, I think if he gets another injury, I don't know. I don't know how much. But I'd like to see him do is win some more majors. Really get golf pumping again. That would be awesome. Other news, we got NFL news. What about Dak? Dak goes for 11. You know, I did one of the hashtag Dak 11. I mean, with Romo getting hurt, I thought, wow. I said, Dallas is done. And then Dak comes onto the scene. But it was a kind of a controversial win. It was ended up being 11. Or was it 17-15? So, I mean, there was a two-point conversion to tie the game try. And apparently, it was overlooked, even by video, that one of the Cowboy players had struck a hands to the helmet of the Minnesota quarterback. So, I mean, it's it's a, you know, it, you know, it's one of those seeing it right at, you know, at the moment. So they're the problem with it is they're Minnesota's upset and they think that they should be able to do is, you know, pushing for reviews at any time. They said defensive tackle Cedric Thompson's right hand smacking Sam Bradford's face mask. The referee said to Bradford, "You never got hit in the face," or whatever like that. He told me I didn't get hit in the face mask. Bradford said making a face. But you know they're trying to. There was a petition in the NFL for them to be able to review anything, even penalties. And, I mean, there's some terrible penalties called. And there's, you know, there's some penalties that get missed. Something like that. You see a guy get hit, hands to the face. You know, but would they have still had challenges? I think, you know, on a call like that, you should be able to challenge it. You know, I would bet there's holding on every play. I mean, the only way you'd ever get away with, you know, taking away the holding is, and I can't believe that they don't, you know, you got these, you know, receivers and stuff, and they wear these nylon jerseys. I mean, I can't believe the ball doesn't come out more often. But, I mean, you just, I mean, I don't know how to stop the holding, because it's not ever going to stop. I mean, there's always going to be penalties, but when somebody makes strikes to the head, then they got to be called. So you look at Dallas already clinching a playoff berth in week 13. My Chicago Bears, Cutler's season-ending shoulder surgery. Possibly Chicago Bears' career-ending shoulder surgery. So it looks like he may not be with the Bears anymore. And, you know, there was rumors that John Fox says that, hey, it's either me or him. Well, it's going to look like Fox is going to get his way. I tell you what, Matt Barkley, I tell you what, if he had some receivers that could catch, you know, they would have won last week. And the week before, they would have won under Cutler. So it's, I don't know what you do. Maybe you put that stick, I'm like in the Replacements. Put that on his hands, you know, so he can catch the ball or something. Give him some gloves. I don't know what. Put him a uniform on that doesn't have that nylon stuff to where it slips out of there. Just in score, Chicago Bulls beat the Cavs 111 to, I think it was 111 to 105 or 111 to 106. I can't remember, but I saw it pop up there. But funny thing about that is LeBron and had a funny bet with Dwayne Wade. Dwayne Wade's a Chicago native. LeBron's Cleveland native. Well, World Series, they bet on it. And the loser had to wear the other team's, not basketball team, the other team's baseball uniform, complete uniform, to the other team's game. So if Dwayne Wade winning, LeBron had to dress up in a full Cubs head-to-toe outfit when he came to visit, Chicago tonight. And if it had been the other way around, if Cleveland would have won, Dwayne Wade would have had to dress up when they went to Cleveland. Well, of course, the Cubs won. And not to say he didn't. He filled his obligations with the bet. Got a lot of crap over it. And it was kind of fun to see. But it's just weird seeing LeBron in a... I mean, as big as he is. I mean, LeBron could have played just about any sport, as good an athlete as he is. You know, you look at... they talked about him playing football. And I think he could have played... easily played football. Probably... I think they said in high school he played as a tight end. But, I mean, he could have, as big as he is, he could probably tackle. He's not used to the hitting. So, yeah, they were talking about... Donovan McNabb was talking about him. He goes, yeah, you get out of the game a while and you don't get hit. I guess McNabb played basketball for Syracuse. And he said, yeah, you know, once you get hit a few times, then you're gonna realize that you picked the right sport, you know, playing basketball. I just think it's funny when they make bets like that. I don't know what the two mayors of each of them make bets, and I have no idea what the mayors bet, but it was glad to see the Bulls win. It's kind of a different revamped Bulls team, a lot different from last couple of years of, you know, getting to know who my Bulls team is. You know, Derrick Rose is gone, and 111-105 it was. So Taj Gibson had 23 points, Dwayne Wade 24 points, LeBron had 27, and Kyrie Irving had 20. So it's good to see the Bulls playing decent. I'm hopefully we can get it going and have a good season for the Bulls. Also, let's see here. Going, we already talked about that. Kind of going off the track of what we sports here. Breitbart had been being attacked as a right wing news organization, and apparently Kellogg had decided to pull all their advertisement with Breitbart. Well, not just, you know, I mean, yeah, I can understand if you don't want to advertise with somebody, but you got to do it a different way, because what they did was, is when they pulled out and they made a statement. I mean, I could just see if you retract your ads, but don't make a statement, because now you did was anybody that was, loyal to Breitbart. Well, Breitbart's doing a dump Kellogg's ad, and right now I think it's over 300,000 people have signed it within a week that they will boycott Kellogg, which it's caused the Kellogg stock to drop almost 4%, 3.7 I think it is percent. Which is a lot of money. And this is a start, because just it's like any, organization, when they rally their members, they get pretty loyal about it. It's like when they tell them don't shop here, don't do this. I've seen it a lot with gun control advocates, where they'll say, if they don't allow me to protect myself, then no money. I've seen that with a few of the businesses like Panera. I'm not sure if Target was attacked by the boycott Target for the transgender bathroom issues. It could be some very expensive political movements by the companies for whatever it is. I mean, it could be somebody that comes out and says they're, against abortion or whatever, and then the liberal left says, well, boycott them. And it happens both sides. I think it's best to do is, if you're running a business, both Republicans and Democrats both buy cereal, and they buy Pop-Tarts and different, you look at the different products that they put out. There's quite a few under the umbrella of Kellogg. But I think it's just easy to do is, you know, could have pulled the ads and done it in a probably a little bit smarter way. I can understand if you don't feel like you want to do is do business with a company or with an organization. If you just feel like you don't want to advertise with them, but you know, you could pull your ads without putting out a statement that you're against everything they do. Apparently also now there's surfacing some people that are suing Kellogg, workers that are coming out saying that, they're working under racist and oppressive supervisors where they're, calling blacks the N-word and, showing pictures of monkeys to them. And I'm like reading this going, are you kidding me? How could a company allow that to go on in this day and age? If I had an employee talking like that or doing that to anybody, I would have to take him outside and say, hey, got to stop. I don't know. It just surprised me. We have also Donald Trump named a Secretary of Defense. That he is a nomination for Secretary of Defense, and he is retired General James Mattis. Well, I had to. Before I get into that, speaking of companies that deal with Kellogg's or that are under the Kellogg's umbrella, you know, you think about it, it's Pringles, Frosted Flakes, Eggo Waffles, Mini Wheats, Cheez-Its, Pop-Tarts, Raisin Bran, Rice Krispies, Apple Jacks, Fruit Loop, Nutri-Grain Bars, Corn Flakes, and Special K. Those are all under that Kellogg brand. That's a lot of people to buy. I mean, I buy Pop-Tarts for my kids and bought Pringles and everything like that. I'm not saying I'm going to boycott them because they don't want to advertise with Breitbart, but I just think that it's like kind of like when Hillary called half of Trump supporters a basket of deplorables. Who is in that basket? She never, and I mean, only half? Well, who's the half? So, but speaking of general, the Secretary of Defense pick, quotes from General Mattis, and I had to, some of these are actually kind of funny when you sit there and listen to them, but this is the mindset of him. He tells it like it is. It says, the article that I'm reading about him, it says, he rarely gives a speech without saying something that should be emblazoned on a coffee mug or in some case stenciled on the side of bombs. And it says, here are his greatest hits. It says, 1, be polite, be professional, but I have a plan to kill everybody you meet. I'm like, okay. Says, 2, no war is over until the enemy says it's over. We may think it's over, we may declare it's over, but in fact, the enemy gets a vote. Probably the other most widely repeated by Madison. Says, 3, says, you are part of the world's most feared and trusted force. Engage your brain before you engage your weapon. Share your courage with each other as we enter to uncertain terrain north of the line of departure. Keep faith in your comrades along the left and the right and the marine air overhead. Fight with a happy heart and strong spirit. Said, Number four, from our first days at San Diego, Paris Island, or Quantico, NCOs bluntly explained to use the core would be entirely satisfied if we gave 100%, and extremely dissatisfied if we gave 99%. And those NCOs taught us the great pleasure of doing what others thought impossible. Number five, now from a distance, I look back on what the Corps taught me. To like men of action and to like men of thought. Number six, I never thought it would be useful. I've always found, give me a pack of cigarettes and a couple of beers and I'll do better with that than I do with torture. Number seven, every morning I woke up and the first three questions I had to do with Iran. It remains the single most belligerent actor in the Middle East. That's what he said. Number eight, you going to Afghanistan? You got guys who slap women around for 5 years because they didn't wear a veil. You know, guys like that ain't got no manhood left anyway. So it's a hell of a lot of fun to shoot them. This is from General Mattis. Number nine. There's some people who think you have to hate them in order to shoot them. I don't think you do. It's just business. 10. The first time you blow someone away is not an insignificant event. That said, there are some a-holes in the world that just need to be shot. There are hunters that need, and there are victims. By discipline, cunning, obedience, and alertness, you will decide if you are the hunter or the victim. It's really hell of a lot of fun, and you're going to have a blast out there. I feel sorry for every son of a bee that doesn't get to serve with you. I can tell that from these statements, his troops are probably going nuts when he says it. And they have to be ready, you know. Number 11, he says, I come in peace. I didn't bring artillery, but I'm pleading with you with tears in my eyes. If you F with me, I'll kill you all. And that was Mattis saying to the Iraqi tribal leaders. Number 12, in a country with millions of people and cars going everywhere, the enemy is going to get a car bomb out there once in a while. There are going to be good days and bad days, bottom line. 13, I think it's very clear that the enemy has decided that the war, the real war, for them, will be fought in the narrative in the media. This is not the place where we're going to take the enemy's capital and run up our flag and drink their coffee. And that sort of thing. And then 14, Marines don't know how to spell the word defeat. And number 15, he goes, I get a lot of credit these days for things I never did. So I think if he will be exactly a no-nonsense Secretary of State, I would not want to have to do and sit across from him and piss him off. He is the type of guy that is no nonsense. There was a report, and I'm sorry whether you like who won or who didn't. Who won as president. Apparently CNN has apologized after a network crew was caught on tape joking about President Donald Trump plane crashing before a live shot on Thursday. It says, while setting up for Trump and the Vice President-elect Mike Pence press conference from carrier headquarters in Indianapolis, a producer is heard off-screen joking with CNN on-air reporter Suzanne Mulliva about the possibility of Trump's plane crashing. That means his plane crashed, the producer tell Malvo, while discussing possible hand signals to aid the network coverage. No, I'm kidding. The video first obtained in a statement Friday, CNN apologized for the jokes and said the producer, who has not been identified, has been disciplined. Yeah. So, yeah, I just think that's something you, I don't care who you voted for or who you wanted to win. You know, it just, that's not what you do. I'm sorry. Shaq come out. Shaq says he won fair and square. Now it's time to give him a chance. Apparently, the one college, Hampshire College, that had so much protest, had removed their flag. Well, they proceeded to put the flag back up and raise it up to full staff. Glad to see them finally come through and support. There was a whole bunch of veterans that went out and turned out. And made them, you know, understand that it hurt them just as much for taking it down. But there was also a ban. Apparently, Santa, Oregon school, the Oregon school district bans Santa Claus decorations. Seeks religious tolerance. And so the district, which made its decision Tuesday, bans images of such as Santa Claus. You may still decorate your door or office if you like, but we ask you to be respectful and sensitive to diverse perceptions or perceptives and beliefs of our community. It says, and refrain from using religious themed decorations or images like Santa Claus, the district said in a statement to staff. So, if they're worried that they're offending people that don't believe in Christmas, then don't take those days off. If you don't feel it's a holiday for you to celebrate, because you don't want to take those days off and offend somebody, then stay in school. I guarantee you they take the same days off. I guarantee you all the kids that are, it doesn't matter. They all will take it off and they'll celebrate their own holiday. But, I mean, you get... So, where they used to celebrate every year, they're supposed to do is, everybody's supposed to do now, is change their belief and the way they celebrate because they don't want to offend people. How do you know it offends somebody? So, I mean, the difference of opinion is, there's an article right here. A Saudi woman faces calls for her execution because she didn't have her hijab on and her veil when she was out. And she didn't have her burqa on covering because you could see her ankles. Her picture was posted on social media. They want to kill her, chop off her head, and throw her to the dogs, some people are talking. I said, seriously. That makes no sense at all. I hope that nothing happens like that. That's just sick. But I wanted to talk about is, how do you know if your house is haunted? And the reason why I want to bring this up is I've had some paranormal experiences at where I work. And I just had one the other day. all by myself out there. It was cold. Nobody was out. I was sitting there working on paperwork. I had all paperwork out. And I had somebody walk up behind me, a big old shadow figure walk up behind me and stand behind me. And I could just feel the darkness right around me. And I was like, what do you want? And I looked to my left and my right, and there was nobody there. And I said, what do you want? And it was just like, I could just feel the presence. And my hair was like standing up, you know, I could just feel that tingly feeling where you get that energy. And, didn't notice anything. I'll have to go back to the camera and see if there's anything there. We got closed circuit TV cameras. I didn't even think about checking them. I'll have to check it. But it was really, it was just, I could just feel the presence and see the shadow. One of the things it talks about, first thing you do, unexplained shadows. It's common. I'll be sitting on my couch, and out of the corner of my eye, I'll see somebody peek around the corner of my of our wall, and I swear there's somebody there looking. Lately, our dog has been just barking at all kinds of things. You get that strange animal behavior they talk about. Your dog will be, barking, or your cat start acting different. Well, we don't have any cats anymore. We used to, but you get the feeling of being watched, that paranormal, that paranoid feeling. You got mild psychokinetic phenomena, hearing a door close or something like that. Well, that I hear. The Jolly Good Fellow. I hear all the time that at work. Where he'll hear something, and it'll be like a bang or whatever, and you're like, what the heck is that? It's always over by our one cooler that we have, and I'm like, it doesn't make sense. Feelings of being touched. Last year it was very common, but being either somebody pushing me or something like that. I haven't heard any cries or whispers. We had a paranormal team come out and investigate, but they were all mostly audio, and they weren't able to find anything on their audio. I'm trying to get another paranormal team to come out. They're supposed to start some renovation here in December, and I think that's going to stir it up. They talk about cold or hot spots, unexplained smells, extreme phenomena would be more like like poltergeist stuff, moving or levitating objects. I haven't seen that yet. I'd love to actually like that. I did have a situation where I was like, God, my right here on the side of my face was stinging. And I went over and looked, and I had three scratches that ran one down my cheek and two across my neck. And people are telling me that it's demonic for the threes. I don't know. I've seen, and one of the guys that works for me, he had at his house, he had scratched twice on his leg, and he had three scratches twice. So I don't know if we have a demonic entity that's getting a little ticked off at us or what, but it talks about things that attract demons or stuff like that. Well, it says signs of a demonic haunting: strange sounds, footsteps, opening doors, closing, whispers, faint screams, moaning, white noise, electric interference. Well, I mean, it's too loud out there with all the coolers and everything running. You just don't hear that. Strange sight shadows. I get that a lot. Flickering lights. I see that on occasions. If I'm going to have to do it. It says religious objects will be destroyed or inexplicably lost, you know, like a crucifix. It says a feeling of discomfort or dread. So the spirit will begin to show itself to a member of the home or environment. Often these demons center their focus on one particular person, and that it can sometimes be a child. Well, we don't have children at the golf course, so. It's an entire homes or rooms are ransacked. We haven't run into that yet. Writing on walls. Phantom mania. A feeling of being held down in bed, and then upon waking, discovering unexplained bruises or scratches on one body. Well, haven't had any holding me down at the golf course, but yeah, I don't know. It just it was been really eerie feeling the last few days. But things can lead to that are withdrawal, anger, resentment, recurrent nightmares and night tremors, unexplained marks on the body, interest in the occult black magic. Well, I don't have any interest in the occult black magic. I have an interest in paranormal, of course. Unexplained illness and weakness. Well, that might be the reason why I don't feel like working out as much. So I did email a lady for her name's Cindy Hagley. She is a realtor that she sells houses that are haunted. And she says if your house is haunted, she can sell it. So that's pretty cool. You just don't hear that too much. You hear usually it's the other way around. When they find out the house is haunted, nobody wants it. Well, apparently people are wanting to move in with all these, you know, ghost shows and stuff like that. People are wanting to do is, move into these haunted houses and stuff like that. It'll be interesting. You know, I'd love to talk with her and interview her, so hopefully we'll get her on the show one of these days. But it's the paranormal field is so wild. You know, you think of some of the things that happen out of that. You wonder what is beyond this physical world that we have now. And I believe that we're not just destined for here. I wish my grandparents or whatever, or friends of mine that have passed. I have one couple. I got a brother-in-law and a really good friend of mine that have passed. That I'd love to, have them. Let me know one way or another. Where they can contact me to tell me that they're all right. I mean, that would be the cool. I don't have any of the psychic ability. Maybe psycho ability, but not psychic. But yeah, I would love to do is have contact with them, so they could, give me the insight that they're fine. That they're, since they moved on. But yeah, with all the stuff that's going on now, they say with all the satanic involvement and stuff like that, it's really making it harder for to get people to go into the priesthood. And I gotta believe it's gotta be that way. But you look at years ago when I was a kid, you didn't hear about demonic possession and doing exorcisms and stuff like that. I got a article here where it was a child welfare worker, a police psychologist, Catholic priests are split on demonic claims. It says police captain Charles Austin said it was the strangest story he'd ever heard. Austin, a 36-year-old veteran of the Gary Police Department, said he initially thought Indianapolis residents Latoya Ammons and her friend concocted an elaborate tale of demonic possessions and supernatural occurrences as a way to make money. But after several visits to their home and interviews with witnesses, Austin simply said, "I'm a believer." Not everyone involved with the family was inclined to believe its incredible story. But whatever the cause for the creepy occurrences that befell the family, whether they were seized by systematic delusions or demonic possession, it led to one of the most unusual cases ever handled by the Department of Child Services. It says many of the events are detailed in nearly 800 pages of official records obtained by the Indianapolis Star and recounted in more than a dozen interviews. Police, DCS personnel, psychologists, family members, and a Catholic priest. You know, you think about that. You know, if you know, something happened like that in a demonic possession, most people are going to think that you're nuts. So what are they going to do? They're going to try to do is institutionalize you. Take your kids away if you got young kids. And turn your life into living hell. Well, apparently this family ended up having to resort to an exorcism. I think they did an article about this one. It was a TV show about this, and the one police officer was standing there, and there was water floating through the house. In air, almost like levitating. It would be... I don't know if I could comprehend or believe, you know, go sit there and see it and go, yeah, that's really happening, and try to process it, you know, because if you see stuff that's levitating, I mean, you know, you watch these scary movies, and what do they do? Oh my God, the power's out. Oh, they got a killer running around. What am I going to do? Oh, I'm going to go take a shower. That's the last thing I'm going to do. Is going to be going to take a shower with the power out, and they got a killer running loose. Yeah, right. But apparently what they do in horror movies, but no, you know, you think about demonic stuff like that. And, you know, if the house all of a sudden just started going, get out, you know, well, then I'd probably get out, you know, I'd probably have to come back with, Father Guido Sarducci as the priest, you know, or somebody. I'd come back and maybe do an exorcism on the house, but that would be a little bit overwhelming to take at one time. So, all right, well, it's been a fast hour already. It's that time. We'll be back Monday. Everybody have a great night, a great weekend, and hey, ain't afraid no ghost. So we'll see you when we see you. And if you see something, say something. And let's see, what do we want to leave with? I wonder if we have any. What do we got here? I don't even know if I have that on here. Maybe this would be. Nope. Figures. Maybe. Let me see if I got it here. Let's see. One more. There we go. Now we got it. We'll leave on this note.